two councilors by phone this evening, and we will proceed. I would like to ask for a moment of silence and the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd also ask us to remember this evening those who died recently in Paris, and if you would just remember them, and I will ask for the Pledge of Allegiance to be led by Mayor-elect Jack Blaylock, and I would ask gentlemen to remove their caps.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mayor-elect Jack Blaylock. We have, beginning the evening with a presentation, wastewater treatment facility, schedule update, and Mr. Blanco, thank you.
Point I'd like to have Suzanne Woodland, the deputy secretary, come forward and walk through a presentation as it relates to the wastewater treatment plant upgrade and the schedule that we anticipate.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the city council.
I can't hear you very well. Okay.
Mayor and members of the city council. Let's, I think, be clear right off the bat. The city has been diligently moving forward since 2007 to evaluate its wastewater treatment options, to test wastewater treatment technologies, and to design the largest public works project in city history in what has become a changing and complex regulatory environment. The city will be at 100% design of an upgraded facility for pure silent by year end. In light of recent misstatements, in my view, by the Conservation Law Foundation's waterkeeper, let's start out with just a little history. In the early 1980s, the city of Portsmouth had designed plans to construct a secondary treatment facility at Pierce Island. Those plans were shelved at the request of the state of New Hampshire. The state of New Hampshire helped the city apply for a 301H waiver from secondary treatment standards, and the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, granted that application for a waiver, thus bringing the city into compliance with the Clean Water Act. The city legally operated under that waiver until its new permit was issued in 2007 with secondary treatment requirements. Now, why would the state and the EPA have supported a 301H waiver from secondary treatment options? Well, there were two reasons. One, funding. There was only so much money to go around. And two, the uniqueness of the Piscataqua River. The Piscataqua River has a similar capacity to handle the flows that it discharged in the treatment plant. And a similar capacity means it can absorb, it can take in, and it can deal with effectively the flows from our treatment plant. And of those flows from the treatment plant at Pierce Island, only a very small percentage reached the Great Bay, given the tidal action and the hydrodynamics of the system. Using a water body's assimilative capacity is the greenest approach to wastewater treatment. No excess energy or chemicals, letting nature do its work. In 2007, the EPA issued a new permit for the Pierce Island Wastewater Treatment Facility, which requires secondary treatment. This change was not due to any demonstrated negative impact on the river. It was due to a change in the Environmental Protection Agency's interpretation and application of the Clean Water Act. Thus, beginning in 2007, the city embarked on a series of actions and decisions relative to the biggest project in city history for public works. And it's a project which will likely be determinative of how the city manages its wastewater for the next 50 or more years. And so what has happened since 2007. A very quick recap. Well, out of the gate, the city had to dedicate resources to deal with the Conservation Law Foundation's appeal of the 2007 permit. We then conducted a wastewater master plan to determine how we could best meet the city's wastewater needs over those next 50 to possibly 100 years. The city council selected Pierce Island for secondary treatment. We piloted some high-rate treatment technologies so we could have a technology that would fit within the fence line of the Pierce Island site. We had changing regulatory requirements, which affected both the size of the plant and its the issue of nitrogen removal of the plant. The city council selected the biological aerated filter technology for this plant, and they commenced design. 90% design plans were submitted to the EPA and the DES in September. And as I stated at the beginning, we'll be at 100% by year end. And while we have been doing this work relative to our wastewater treatment facility options, we've completed our long-term control plans projects. We had a number of them outlined in the consent decree. They are done, and we are now doing a round of studies to determine their effectiveness and next steps. So as I said before, where are we now? 100% by year end. What is left to do? Local permitting. Incorporating DES and EPA comments into final plans. Pre-qualifying bidders. Bid the project. Need bond authorization. And if there are no unforeseen conditions, we could pass on the contract by July 1. So when will we be complete and operational? Under normal construction methods, which means a single shift most of the time, there's often second shift work when you're doing a project of this magnitude during larger construction bores, but most of it would be single shift. It's a 47-month construction schedule to reach substantial completion and a 4-month start of operations. If we assume a July 1st start date, substantial completion is May of 2020, and compliance with permit, September 2020. And so why does it take so long to build? This is an $80 million project. Approximately $65 million of that is in construction of a complex system. There are over 600 plan pages. Plans, those large sheets detailing pipes and electrical systems, all needing to be reviewed one by one to make sure what happens and is described on plan page number 4 is carried over to plan page number 21 and plan page number 81. It all has to fit together. And that means it's complicated to construct. And this project will have to be constructed on a tight site, which you all know and understand, you've been there, with a treatment plant that must be kept operational. And that is a big issue. Because much of this work must be sequenced and closely coordinated with operations staff. We need to keep the electricity moving, going. We need to make sure the systems are all functioning while you're constructing around it, interconnecting, disconnecting, reconnecting. It's very complicated. So why has the completion date changed over time? Well, the original date in the consent decree was May 2017. And you might remember that that was for a smaller secondary only treatment plant. In July of 2012, however, several months, literally after the City Council voted for the May 2017 date, we got a letter from the Environmental Protection Agency advising of likely nitrogen limits in our next wastewater permit for Pierce Island. Secondary treatment removes some nitrogen, but not enough to meet the limits that were described in that letter from made it a bigger plant. The design flow for this new plant is 6.1, not the 4.3 smaller plant that was part of the design for the earlier date. So in June of 2013, the city formally put the EPA on notice that it would need to extend the completion schedule to November 2018 in order to construct this larger plant capable of removing nitrogen. And as you know from the times I've been here before you, we had some tentative agreement from EPA and DES for that longer date, recognizing that we were building a larger plant with nitrogen removal capability. So what has changed to require this additional time? There are a variety of factors. One, the PEAS evaluation caused a slowdown in the design process, more than frankly we anticipated. It did slow down the process a little bit. Second, when you move from 10% design plans to 90% design plans, you discover things about the work that you need to do. For example, we discovered that one of our buildings has PCBs and that needs to be dealt with in a particular way for the project. We also discovered that some of the work that we had hoped could be done concurrently, starting building over here, starting building over there, working sort of at the same time to do two pieces of the project, no longer be done that way. It's a sequencing issue now for most of the project. So you add those and some other factors together and you get a 47-month construction schedule. And as you might expect, I asked a lot of questions in terms of that schedule. Can we shorten it up? What can we do? And there aren't a lot of good answers. So the city will be preparing a statement of position as part of a formal dispute resolution process with the Environmental Protection Agency. And the city's statement of position will be submitted by December 10th and detail more of these reasons in terms of the request for the schedule extension. It will be a public document, and thereafter the EPA will have an opportunity to respond to our statement of position. And their response will be expected on or before January 24th. So that will be our next steps. And as I said, when I heard the 47-month construction schedule, I asked, can it be built faster? Maybe, but there are costs and risks and other impacts. You could, for example, add second or third shifts, evening and night work. Of course, night work is less efficient. You don't get one-for-one deliverable in terms of time of the project. The risk of errors increases. Greater safety hazard, both for workers and for operational staff. And keep in mind, if we're operating a treatment plant throughout the construction project, that's a real risk for our folks. Add to the fact that with evening and night work, we have truck traffic and construction noise in the evening and night, which is an issue for the summer recreational cultural activities and obviously the residents of the South End and others who may be affected by that construction activity. So I think what I'll do is why don't I leave it there, and if there's questions or what you'd like, but I think it probably were, from my perspective, you know, since potential nitrogen limits in a future permit, and it was an issue of concern for the staff. It varied from what we thought we had agreement on. Subsequent to our hearing before the City Council in August, Terry Damaris, the city engineer, and I have had conversations with the permit writers from EPA, and we were able to report that we have agreement, if you will, in terms of what the permit limits might look like or what might be incorporated into a consent decree as an alternative for action levels to undertake the nitrogen removal. So we have had some very positive conversations, which is what has led us to recommend continuing with the design.
So that's very encouraging. So really, no one is in disagreement in terms of where the final result of construction, whether it's 2 years or 4 years, that we're all in agreement on the same page in terms of what we're designing, right?
Correct.
And the council's already approved this year at least rate increases to that effect. We've gone on record twice to say we're going to build a plant on Pierce Island and at those treatment limits. So the only thing we're in a debate about is with the calendar. And it's not a sense of the city is trying to delay things. Is that?
That would be correct. As far as where we have had our communications with EPA, it's about the same.
And Councilor Dwyer can speak to the complexity of building just a school at half the cost. This is something in terms of magnitude, twice the complexity at least, maybe probably more, twice the cost. And it seems jammed in there. I mean, you spoke to the risk and the nuisance, but I don't know, your body language didn't really, I don't think it touched on really what we're talking about here in terms of the risk to doing. I know how people operate three shifts, and they're not going to be at high-performing people. And the neighborhood is just going to, I mean, you're going to hear trucks backing up, pile driving at 2 in the morning, the Klieg lights on to keep things running. I think that it's okay for someone living in Elliott to say, hey, you guys should just get it done. But I don't think that's the prudent thing to do. So I don't know, there's nothing on the agenda that says asking for council decision. But I support the request for formal dispensation.
We wanted to make sure the council was fully aware of this because it will be a formal dispute. And we wanted to make sure not only you were advised, but also the public. We could have done this. We debated about doing this in non-meeting, and we chose not to. We thought it's important that the public knows what issues that we have. Right in the middle of designing our secondary treatment plan, as was said by the deputy city attorney, we ended up changing over to the nitrogen issue. So we had to go back to the drawing board. So, and even as far back as 1989, with the state saying, please do not put in a secondary treatment plant, we don't have the money, we'll help you with the 301H waiver. That also was something that took place. So, I will just say unequivocally, unless something happens unusual, the city of Portsmouth is going to have 100% design plans. We're going to be submitting them to EPA, and we're going to be proceeding to build the plant. It will get built in accordance with TN of 8, and if we have to, we will come back to the city council with any other adjustments that have to be made.
Councilor Warren. Thank you, Suzanne, for laying all this out for us and for the public. I think there is a mistaken impression on the part of the CLF and some members of the public that the city is dragging its feet somehow. Your statement